So again, you know, this is overview. So there are four objectives today's presentation. So let's understand addiction is a very complex condition. And that's why the case that I'll discuss today, even if you've not read, I'll probably tell about the case. Then we'll go to different types of substances very briefly, not in detail. Then look at the magnitude of the problem, how big it is in the whole world. And also look at the Indian studies, which have recently come up. And an overview of management about what available with us and what you can do for these people. Okay, now looking at the addiction is a different perspective. Yeah, so there are many theories. At the beginning, it's a moral theory. Addiction is bad. People with bad nature get into addiction. Then it evolved over the time. And at this point of time, the best understanding of addiction is a combination of three models, bio, psycho, and social model. So all three models are contributing. That is, at this point of time, the best understanding about the addiction. Now, coming back to a simple definition, but I think you should all remember this definition or note it down definition. So let's be available so that you are clear in the mind, and when you sing somebody, you are absolutely clear, because it's a very misused term also. So addiction is a treatable chronic medical disease involving complex interaction among brain circuits, genetics, environment, and an individual life experiences. So this at this point of time, this looks like a very solid and standard definition, which has been validated by the research studies. Okay, coming to a little bit more. So addiction, when person develop an addictive disorder or addiction, it's known as chronic brain disease. So involvement of primarily three areas. Many of you must be knowing the area from ventral tegmental area to nucleus accumbens and to prefrontal cortex. So these are the key areas which are involved in the addiction. The research tells that once you get addicted, the addictive substance hijack this path. So this path is involved in normal reward circuit. You do some good things, you do something, you went for a running, a jogging, something you like, you did, same path get activated. But in addiction, what happened? The addictive substance hijack whole track. So then addiction become a priority compared to the normal pleasurable things we do in our normal life. So that's how been understood this pathway. Coming to types of addiction, I think we have some question in between. So broadly two types, just chemical and non-chemical. Chemical addictions, alcohol, tobacco, opium, stimulant, I mean many and all. And at this point in time, if you look at non-chemical addiction, only two are diagnosable addictive condition. Not everything, gambling and gaming. Any excessive behaviors are not addiction. I mean, many times people tell, person telling lie more. Is it addictive liar? Person is watching pornography a lot. Is it pornographic addiction? No. At this point of time, what research has told us that gambling and gaming are non-substance addiction as a condition. Okay, now coming to substances, legal or illicit substances, that means you can get it. You can walk down the street and purchase it. Alcohol, tobacco, and few medications like sleeping pills, that's benzodiazepine, alprazolam, diazepam, lorazepam, codeine containing cough syrups. I think people from North India, majority of North India might have come across correct type of syrups. Painkillers like tramadol, now tapentadol, antihistaminics, and some other psychotropics are also known as, can be addictive. Now, right side is illegal substances. As this boy who just now discussed, he using cannabis. Cannabis at this point of time illegal. Then we have brown sugar, smack, heroin, same name, fentanyl injection. So these are opioid groups. Stimulants, which are again, not probably because we're expensive, not everybody uses, but it's definitely you must be reading newspapers and all. Cocaine, amphetamine, all are stimulants, methamphetamine. Hallucinogens are LSD and ecstasy. Inhalants, which is a poor man's drug, a poor street children's, glue and whiteners and in all these inhalants. So that's how it is. Now, if we look at the substances and how they work in the brain, broadly three: stimulant, hallucinogen, depressant. So when a person takes the substances, it goes to brain and works broadly three path. So if you look at stimulant, caffeine, anybody, anytime you feel bored today, you can have a coffee, you feel good. All of us feel good having caffeine, tobacco, cocaine, amphetamine are broadly stimulants. Now, what are depressant? Alcohol, opioids, and benzos. So that's why you must have seen a person who is drunk or intoxicated, they lie flat, irrespective of where they are, in the street or anywhere. But it's a depressant. They depress the brain. So they feel sleepy and slow off. Whereas you'll not find, let somebody take amphetamine, you'll not find him to sitting quietly, will jumping, overactive, you know, shouting, screaming. So most of the cocaine amphetamine are the people, young people who goes to, let's say, rape party or night out party where you have to dance a lot, who needs energy. You can't dance, you know, so that's been used more. Similar hallucinogens, you know, ketamine, phencyclidine, LSD, MDMA. The many street names are there. You can Google and find out, but these are the major chemical group. Cannabis actually doesn't fall anywhere. It's like a mixture of everything. So one of the dirty drug is cannabis. So they say managing cannabis is more tougher than any other drugs because it touches all the receptors in the brains. So it's very difficult to target what you want to do it. And this is something I think you should remember. If 100 people experiment in nicotine, only 30 will be addicted. And 100 people experiment alcohol, only 10 will be addicted. So, you know, so don't think that anybody is drinking alcohol experimentally once a while, social drinking is addicted. No, it's not like that. So an experimental recursion use. So it's a progressive path. Then you start the intoxication. Intoxication is the first milestone where things are going beyond control. That no, things are not going good. So somebody is intoxicated. Like he drank, well and fine, but drank, got to brawl, fighting, you know, screaming. That's something things are going out of order. Then hazardous use, harmful use, and dependence. So dependence is the end part of the thing. So it's like if you look at any disease, end is dependence. So that's why dependence is very difficult to manage. The reason we all joined here that we don't want people to go to dependence. We want to treat them early. So if they go to dependence, the outcome is not very promising. Let's be, you know, clear about these things. Dependence outcomes are not very promising. You are looking at the end of the spectrum. So any end of the spectrum, all of us know it's been not very promising. So we all, the reason of the doing this whole training or, you know, the mission and vision is that can we prevent people to develop this stage? Can you prevent them to help them out or, you know, make them much better? Okay, so all is not always true. There should be other spectrum, other, we'll discuss later, there should be other features. See, for example, if I study a lot, am I addicted to study? Correct. Or if I play a lot. So there are other features. I mean, again, scientifically I'm talking about. We'll probably discuss sometime later. I think next slide, it is there. See, excessive use may be a criteria, but not does not always mean the addiction. Okay, now this is very important slide. I think you have to take one message in the whole print. This is one. When you want person to tell about addiction or dependence, these are the symptoms. By one, left side is ICD-10, International Classification of Disease. Number 10 was given by WHO. World Health Organization has given this ICD-10. DSM-5 is the latest one, but given by American Psychiatric Association or American government. So these two, so look at the criteria, just glance it, no need to do by heart. We'll obviously take, again, one defining each substance. Today's case presentation, we'll try to also, when we meet, we'll tell what is what, but just have a glance so that you can get idea. So again, at the end, you can see there should be three or more of the following has to be there, we call addiction. And here, I think more than two has to be there, called substance use disorder. So DSM-5 uses substance use disorder. ICD-10 uses substance dependence. So this is how we define. Now coming to the next part, how prevalent is it? How do you think? How many people in India are drank alcohol in the last 6 months? Out of 100, how many must have tested alcohol in the last 6 months? This is a alcohol consumption per person. Matlab, in country, per person, how much liters of alcohol they're drinking in the country, in a country. Okay. Now, where is India falling? 6 liter. This includes not a drink, only drinker, everybody, all including per person. So if in India, the data is telling about 6 liter per person. And obviously, Soviet countries and all much higher, all of us know, you know, we are not talking about addiction here. Type of culture like Western culture where alcohol is a part and parcel of, you know, your daily life. So that doesn't mean they're addicted. I'm talking about the consumption only, okay? Our India is a taboo. Instead of taboo, this is a drinking. So interesting part in India is that those who drink, they drink till drunk. You must have seen many things. Whereas that's not in other countries. That's not in other countries. And I will come back and tell the data for that. So that you can see. So many culture where alcohol has been a part of their life does not mean that people are drinking till drunk. Remember that part. Okay, now global prevalence. Again, now look at dependence. Obviously, it's 100 million. Cannabis, 22 million, and opioid, about 26.8 million. Let's look at the last one, World Drug Report. So 275 million use drug at least once. This doesn't include alcohol, only drug. And 31 million suffer from drug use disorder. And 4,50,000 people died as a consequence of drug use in the world. Okay, now coming to India. So this is actually two studies I'll quote here. One is National Mental Health Survey. Both are available in Google. You can Google and find out. The National Mental Health Survey is a household survey conducted by NIMHANS for Ministry of Health and Welfare. It picks up all disorders of psychiatry. Remember, it picks up disorders, not the symptoms. It picks up disorders, it's a disease. So ICD-10, diagnosable disorder. In this case, alcohol is around 4.65. Coming back to the latest one, a National Household Survey by All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Delhi. Look at this is last, if I know correctly, 6 months or 1 year, I'm forgetting. Last 1 year, I think, yeah, 1 year. How many people has drank alcohol? 16 crores. 16 crores of Indians, so 14.6% out of 100, 14 people has drank at least once. Again, remember, it's combination of male and female. So if you take out female, if you look at whole data, take out the female, it jumped over and double. Some, I think if I remember, 28% or 29% Google. But because female data is included, so it's actually decreases because, you know, in our country, female users are much lesser. That's why the number looks less. So it comes around 28 or 27% if male only. Again, same comes here. Now, how many are using problematically? 5.7 crores, 5.2%. So problematic means what? That drinking, getting accident, violence, brawl, physical harm. They may not be dependent, but they are developing these problems. If you look at strictly dependent criteria, around 3%, 2.7%. Again, if you take out the female, it jumped to 6 to 7%. So this is how it is. At this point, this is how it in the Indian scenario. So if you look at the picture, so again, the picture is very nice. You can see out of 10, 1, 2, 3, 3, 6, 9, 18. So out of 18, only 1 is to 17. One female, 17 male. So that comes, if you extrapolate to the graph, the data will be skewed in that way. You know, obviously numbers will go up for the male. Opioid, obviously, opioid is illicit substance. So you can see 2.3 crores users and 28 lakh dependent users. Again, this data is available. I'll tell three only. There are many more in the, you can Google and find out. Cannabis, again, bhang 40 lakh. Charas and Ganja, 50 lakh. So this is a national drug use survey conducted in 2019. Very well done survey. Whenever you get time, just Google. Whenever you are presenting something, this is one of the best data to presented to the, you know, about the audiences. The last few slides, what are the social vulnerabilities for substance use? What makes people to be more vulnerable? Obviously, poverty, illiteracy, employment sector. I think she's mentioning that certain professions are more vulnerable. Youth and unemployed. And vulnerable sections of society. You know, there are sections of society who are more marginalized, more vulnerable, there are chances more, and a cohort, a group of people get addicted. Okay, adolescent, what is happening? Adolescent, now it's a, you know, big thing. Look at what happens to adolescent. The boy I just presented the case is an example of adolescent substance use. Availability. Now he is doing engineering, cannabis is easily available with internet and all, things are much easier to approach, easier to get, irrespective of where you are located in the world, accessibility and acceptability, drug use. Remember, so if your parents are very permissive, they, you know, allow certain things. Take up alternative engagement. And this example, if I in COVID, you know, look at what happened to our family members and kids. I mean, there's nothing to do for them. I mean, what are they going to do? Because of distancing, they cannot go out. So the causing is creating another problem. Pure influence in media. I mean, all of us know how media highlights substance use is a big thing. Poor skills and coping, poor life skills and coping skills, all of us know. Stressful life events, premorbid temperament, and this is very critical. I mean, if the boy you discussed, you must have certain points I mentioned there, externalizing symptom, poor impulsivity, emotional discontrol. So those are not related to drug, those are temperament, that there is there, you know, some sort of, what do you call, swabhav, you know, in Hindi. So that makes people vulnerable to start. And family history also plays a role, genetic vulnerability modeling. Family support, I mean, who is a family, who is a primary caregiver, who is emotionally attached, and all these things can play in adolescent. Not everything has to be there, but they can play a role. Now, what's the consequences? I think this is, all of you know it again. You know the study done in India in NIMHANS quite some time back by a community team, they realized that alcohol intoxication is one of the commonest problem for head injury. coming to new Mars, because it's a, you know, we have emergency 24/7. And following this, fortunately, the government started using, you know, compelling the using helmet quite some time back. But the many cases of head injury, they found alcohol is the one of the culprit. Psychosocial, like anxiety, depression, concomitant things, familial and marital discord, we all know. So many of us, you must be knowing, substance affects family before affect them. Family get into so much of disruption, so much of distraught, then, you know, before the person get. So social, as you know, respect comes down, stigmatization happens. Absenteeism, I mean, one of the commonest absenteeism is actually because of alcohol. And Dr. Pratyamurthy, ma'am, has done a study looking at the public sector drivers. You must have heard of this, you know, roads transport companies. So she looked at longitudinally and tried to find out why, let's see, the road transport company conductors and drivers are taking leave so frequently. And the most common cause found is alcohol. And then what used to happen that time, their supervisor will dismiss them. But madam told that, why don't you have a facility to detoxify and give help? So actually, they following this company put a social work team who actually started, you know, following them aggressively. And because they're very good workers, they're good drivers, I mean, good conductors. And you can't, you know, run an organization without skilled people. So now that company become in profit. And many people got a benefit before, you know, before they used to be completely dismissed. Financial, poor management, you know, money is a misery of everything. And many of your family will tell, the moment the day money comes, in a couple of seconds, everything goes off. So that's again the problem. And violence, physical violence, intimate partner violence, all are very closely linked with the alcohol, the management. Okay, now again, I'll talk about approaches only. Detail we'll discuss as we go further. So management for intoxication, somebody overdosed, taken heavy drinking, heavy opioids, how to manage withdrawal, prevention of relapses, reduction of harm. So you realize that this person is not willing to stop completely. Can you decrease the amount to decrease the harm? So, you know, that is an approach. And pharmacological and psychosocial approaches. If you look at preventive methods, these are the four prevention. Like if you are working in the school, mental health, where prevention is more important. So reduce the risk factor. We already discussed a few of the risk factors at the beginning. Target whole spectrum of drug use, just not substances. Tailor-made intervention. Remember, there's not a single intervention for everybody. So you have to personalize intervention and enhance the protective factors. The broadly areas where you can work on the prevention aspect. Similarly, you look at for example, you want to look at what are risk factors and what protective factors. Simple. So in individual level, early aggressive behavior. If you look at the case I discussed, a lot of aggressive behavior at the beginning. Those are risk factors. What protects a person? Self-control. Similarly, poor social skills. Somebody, you know, the boy I'm talking about, he feels that the girl has not looking at him or not taking care of him, but he's not able to move on. So he's not able to cope up. I mean, you know, many part adolescent pass through these phases, and that is perpetuating his cannabis use also. Almost the breakup has happened almost 2 years, 1.5 years back, but still he continues. Whereas positive relationship, lack of parental supervision, parental monitoring and support. Again, this has been a big issue for the COVID-19 and use of technology by many young people, because both parents go to working and they don't want to. Similarly, peer substance abuse versus academic competence, school drug availability, what will protect is anti-drug use policy in the schools, and the community, strong neighborhood attachment protects people where poverty is a risk factor. So there are different interventions are available. I mean, you all know it. So the fifth one is that we are doing here now. You're increasing your skill so that you become a champion and you start intervening, you know, in areas prevention as well as treat the people. There are many other ways to do it, but this is just put an example there. Okay, I've done my presentation. Thank you very much.